Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the World Championship Series America Round of 8. I'm Nathanius. With me is my Terran brother, QXC. And we have a Terran match to cast.
Terran versus Zerg.
Terran versus Zerg.
Terran match would be like two Terrans.
Yeah, but Terran is the important part. And it's two really good players. Polt against Hyun, Season 1 champion from 2014. Hyun against Polt, who won Season 2 and 3 last year. Basically a clash of the kings, right? The old and the new.
Yeah, and I think maybe the most recent time that they fought was, I want to say the last MLG. That's the most recent, like, really vivid time that I remember them dueling.
Yeah, they've had a lot of big clashes, including MLG final last year, too.
Right.
But, you know, let's hear what the players have to say. We've got Clutch up on the main stage just to pick the brains of our next two competitors.
Thank you, gentlemen. To my right, he is Captain America himself, Polt. And to my left, the current champion of WCS America, Hyun. Gentlemen, congratulations on making it to the round of 8. Polt, any words for your opponent before we start?
This match is very, I think it's very tough for both of us. So whoever wins this, I think hopefully he wins the tournament.
Well said, Polt, well said. Hyun, any words before we start?
최승우 선수한테 한마디. 일단 제가 지면은 4강에 사태란이 될 가능성이 높은 것 같아가지고 재밌는 경기를 하면서 이길 수 있도록 하겠습니다.
There's a good chance that semifinals would consist of all four Terrans, so I'm going to be the one that stops at least one of the Terrans from advancing. I'm going to try my best to show you guys a good show. Yeah, without making it look too easy.
All right, gentlemen, good luck and have fun. Back to the desk.
Thanks, Clutch. Interesting words coming out. Hyun, when I look at this, when I looked at the top 8 originally, I thought, you know, Hyun is probably the guy to be the only non-Terran to move on. When we look at who's favored in each of these matchups, surely Alicia had a chance, but I think Hyun, this is not an unwinnable series for him.
I definitely imagined Alicia actually coming out over Bomber 3-2 the other way, but two Terrans already advancing, and Hyun definitely, yeah, I would agree, the one of the greatest contenders for not only making it out of the round of 8, defeating the overpowered Terrans, but also perhaps taking the entire tournament.
Yeah, he's, you know, one of the stronger players when you look at it. And since he did win last season, you've got the expectations to move on even forward. And we've loved hearing your guys' expectations, your predictions on what's going on. So let's hear a little bit more about what you guys have been saying over at the social media desk with Nikki B.
All right, well, I've got one pretty good tweet that I'm going to read to you guys. It's from at XE4RO, and it says, "Ha ha at QXC casting Terran, so much hype. Pretty good. Hashtag WCS. Woo!" And update on our question of the day. We're now at 122 mules. Woo! All right, so just a reminder for all of you SC2 fans who are looking for a bit more competition, and you can make it out to the Atlanta area July 11th through 13th, make sure that you sign up for Red Bull Battlegrounds at battlegrounds.redbull.com for a chance to get your share of the $25,000 prize or 4,000 WCS points. You can use the code WC15 for 15 off. Now, if you're looking for tournaments, we also have 3 qualifiers coming up that you don't want to miss. Those are on July 15th, 16th, and 19th. So sign up now at nationalesl.com/us/SC2. All right, back to you guys.
Thanks, Nikki. And of course, we love to see you guys coming in, trying to sign up play in WCS, you can be that guy that knocks me out of the qualifying bracket and gets stomped by this guy in the next round. We're getting ready to go into the veto process, though, and it's cool to see new faces come up in these qualifiers and these offline events.
Yeah, some of these offline events are a great way for players to prove themselves, establish their foothold within the cutthroat community of esports and pro gaming. And here we go on the map vetoes. Only because it's a best of five, remember, there's only one veto per player.
What's your least favorite map is Terran, quick, before Polt goes.
You mean in TVZ?
Yeah.
Sejong.
Sejong? I think Polt's going to be a Sejong.
Hmm.
I got the Waystation veto from Hyun. I'm not surprised by that. Polt played some
Habitation.
Habitation Station.
He doesn't like Roach Hydra.
Yeah. It has been one of the maps where some of those Roach pushes have been really difficult to deal with.
Habitation Station, because of the very close rush distance, the very small distance between some of the bases, and the very limited amount of airspace. There's a lot of airspace to the main, but besides that, there's almost no airspace at all. Makes it a very suitable map for going Roach Hydra.
I think King Sejong Station to start this series is a pretty good map. I like it in this matchup. Maybe we go around as the second one. I feel like I would have expected Frost or Overgrowth earlier.
Yeah, perhaps Hyun has a particular strategy planned for Merry-Go-Round.
I don't think Merry-Go-Round's too bad for some of those Roach pushes either.
Yep, because of the big wide open area around outside the third, there's very small, there's not really any choke points there, which means that Roach Hydra can kind of span out, push in, make a big engagement, very hard for a Terran player to hold.
And Frost, of course, very standard map choice, can pretty much fit anywhere in the best of five order. Overgrowth next, and then Alter Zeam as a fifth map.
Unsurprisingly.
Yeah, no one... Nope. Hyun doesn't play on this map a lot because most Terrans would veto it, and as a Terran, Paul, you don't want to play on Alter Zeam versus Zerg.
Yeah, very few players. Even when I talk to Zerg players, it's like nobody wants to play on Alter Zeam. The Terrans think it's Zerg-favored, the Zergs think it's Terran-favored, and everybody vetoes it.
But we all know it's Zerg-favored.
Terrans.
So the first map's going to be King's Stage and Station. What do you like on this map? Because we've seen... What's up?
Huh? Sorry, what'd you say?
I'm being bamboozled here. What do you like on King's Sejong Station? Talk to me.
How about I tell you what I don't like about King's Sejong Station?
All right, let's go.
The second entrance into your natural means that you have a lot more possibilities for defending against all ends. Those Roach plays, it's usually like a 1-1 Roach timing or even that 2-2 Roach timing. All of a sudden, instead of only defending your third, you have the possibility of your opponent swinging around and going into your natural, which means if you get just a little bit behind where in order to defend that timing, you need a whole lot of bunkers. You need a whole lot of bunkers in two different places, which makes it very frustrating.
Yeah, especially since you have that kind of wide open area. There's only like that one chasm outside the third base. If you spawn in like the bottom right, like that chasm on the left side doesn't give you too much space to work with if the Zerg hits you from two directions.
Yeah, well, it's not as much that like, oh, they're pincering you. Because those two locations are too far away to really get pincered.
Yeah.
It's that you have to commit your army to two different places. And it's very hard to keep track of exactly where your opponent's army is moving through. And if you need to build those bunkers, you know, four bunkers to defend a 2-2 Roach Hydra max out timing is not unreasonable. Eight bunkers is a little more unreasonable. And then siege tanks being so slow to reposition, it can be a real nightmare depending on how the situation plays out.
Yeah, I'm interested to see where Hyun takes this as we're getting into the lobby for the first map. Mostly because, you know, we've been talking about Roaches and Hydralisk, but Hyun can play standard pretty well, too.
Yeah.
We've seen him even more so recently playing around with the Mutaling, Baneling style. Of course, other players like Violet have been really showing a lot more of the Roach builds, but Polt likes to open up with delayed upgrades and a delayed third command center. Can Hyun abuse this in any way? Because Polt loves to get that fast Viking and then usually some sort of follow-up drop or other aggression.
Yeah, it's definitely Hyun. I was looking at, or I was watching as he was practicing. I was like, hey, Hyun, it's time to eat. And when I looked at his computer, he had a text document open just full of build orders. And he was like, no. Now it's build order time. I was like, okay, all right, we'll eat later. And so I know Hyun's been preparing for this matchup a lot. He's definitely got a lot of information about what Polt has been doing recently. Polt, one of the most, I don't want to say he's one of the most predictable players because there's lots of players that are predictable. He's one of the best players who is also very predictable. He tends to play a very similar style.
over and over and over, but he does it so well that he's still able to crush through. It'll be very interesting to see how confident is Hyun going into the series that Polt is going to act as expected, and how confident is he in trying to meta that style? And we'll have to see that as the first game gets underway.
Yeah, I think another really good point that you bring up is, you know, Polt, you can almost kind of expect what you're going up against when you go into a series against him, but he also does his own special thing. He's not, most players, I feel like, when you have your own build that you really like, it kind of puts you at a disadvantage that people can prepare and study it. But Hyun, as we know, a very good player who did win season one and didn't have to play a crazy amount of Zerg versus Terrans, but as we know, he's also very highly placed in WCS as far as overall rankings go. So even if he was eliminated at this stage, very comfortable position to get to BlizzCon at the end of the year. And I think up against a player like Polt, those points might matter just a little bit more for the CM Storm Terran, even though he is also quite high up himself. But Hyun's just, I'd say he's in one of the more comfortable positions where he can afford to lose a lot and still make it to the global finals.
Yeah, if that's his goal. But at number two, it's hard to imagine how he wouldn't. He'd get bumped all the way out of that ranking, yeah, all the way up to 17, where he wouldn't be invited. Hyun's got to be looking at the here and now. You know, BlizzCon is still quite a ways away. And who cares about BlizzCon if you don't perform well at every tournament before that? He wants to go into this, crush as much as he can, prove himself to be stronger than Terran, than Polt, one of his decisive rivals for over a year now. They've been meeting in quite a number of tournaments, contending for numerous championship titles.
Polt's always been like a staple Terran, right? When we look at the StarCraft community, and Polt and Hyun also former teammates. More known than Hyun, who really made 2013 his year with his Valencia win and really picking up a lot of foreign tournament high placements. But this is a series that is really tricky, because I feel like if you look at the top level players that are mostly playing in the American or European scene, this is about as even a match as you get.
Yeah, for sure. And we're getting into it. The game has started to load. We're going into Sejong Station. And recently from Polt, I think we've been seeing Reaper into pretty fast Marauder drop with some Hellion run-bys, possibly some Hellbat play. But again, Polt's had a week to prepare for this match too.
Yeah, if you're playing against an opponent that likes roaches, I wouldn't be surprised if he did his, you know, he builds four Marauders back home, like you mentioned, usually follows up the Viking with a Marauder drop, and in some cases with a Hellbat as well. So Hyun needs to be prepared for just about anything. I think, is playing into roaches too predictable of Hyun to do, or can both of these players just kind of do their thing without worrying about being metagamed?
I don't think Hyun needs to worry about Polt doing some really offbeat strategy to counter what he's predicting, unless Polt brings a different Polt to this tournament. But based on what we've seen from him in the past, very predictable, very stable, solid player. Once he finds something that he likes, he tends to use it quite a bit.
All right, we'll have to see if he does the same thing he's been doing for a while. In the top left of King Sejong Station, he's our red Terran player from CM Storm. It is Polt. And his opponent in the bottom right, a man who likes roaches a lot, in blue from Team Rollcat, it is Hyun.
My voice is getting scratchy. Thanks for that.
I got you back. Player intros are like my thing.
They're your thing. All right.
We'll have
a competition for the next game.
All right.
We'll have We'll each do one, and then we'll have the crowd judge
based on the cheers. This crowd has been pretty awesome too. Shout out to you guys. Shout out to our European audience too. There's some people that have been tweeting. They're staying up really late to watch these games.
Good. They should be.
These games are worth watching.
They are worth watching.
And if already something unusual, QXC.
Oh yeah. What was the supply? I think that was a 14. No, I'm sorry. I didn't.
It's a fast pool.
Yeah, it was. I think it was a 14 pool. And it looks like he'll probably just go hatchery after that. No gas being started here. So it's basically just a slightly safer version of a pool hatch expand. And it also gives some opportunities for early Ling aggression, depending on how early he builds the Zerglings. So he's actually saving larva,
which is indicative that he's going to build three lings as soon as this pull finishes. And what he'll do is basically try and sneak around the expected Reaper. Almost everybody's opening Reaper. Pult especially, very unlikely to go CC first. The Overlord's going to get into the natural. If he was going CC first, he'd probably see it by now. So the Lings will kind of be sneaking around the map, dodging that Reaper. And the objective here is by the time the Reaper gets to Hyun's base and identifies that this was not hatchery first, the Lings are doing some damage. So we'll have to see what path Hyun decides to take. The Overlord, you can see, is coming in. This Overlord in the center of the map is really important because he's going to use it to see where the Reaper is going. And that allows him to send his Lings the other way. This is 100% guaranteed to dodge the Reaper when he executes it in this way. And the Lings are able to get into Pult's natural. He's going to be able to deny the CC for a short period of time. Reaper goes in. Pult really wants to check the gas timing. This is very important to know what kind of follow-up it is. And meanwhile, sees no gas, but in the natural, SEV dies. Second Reaper comes out, and Pult, he may actually have to cancel this command center.
This is a rough loss for Pult. That command center does get canceled, and a very well executed early aggressive play by Hyun to knock Pult back at the start of this game. And these Zerglings are still going to be able to see, okay, you have one gas, your factory's just started. I mean, Hyun, he really couldn't be more comfortable in this position, just cranking out drones. Now he doesn't have too much to worry about.
Yeah, this could not have gone worse for Pult. Look at how flustered he is right now. His command center, he didn't even restart it until he's up to somewhere in the range of 800 minerals. And I say 800 because the factory is kind of, he was at 700 minerals, but the factory had already been started. There was no reason to wait so long to rebuild that command center. And you can see the two command centers now are timed out within 5 or 10 seconds of each other. The second command center should be almost done by the time the third one finishes. And now Hyun, with these three queens, is not going to take any damage at all from the Reapers. Pult may try and use his Reapers to go around a little bit, but if we look at the Harvesters in the next couple of minutes, you'll see a very decisive advantage for Hyun.
Yeah, this is a nice position to be in as a Zerg. Pult wants to check when that third hatchery gets taken, but, you know, one thing that you mentioned earlier, Pult wanted to check the gas timing of Hyun. Hyun opening gasless at the beginning of this game as these Reapers continue to poke. He's now taken two geysers in his main base. I mean, what are the chances that we see roaches from this point?
Off of gasless, roaches is probably the most common transition, and we do see the roach warren going down. I think this is a really intelligent way for Hyun to punish the delayed economy of his opponent. He immediately wants to follow up. He's like, all right, I messed you up. Now you're behind, and now I'm gonna do a timing before the game goes too long, and that damage that I did early on becomes less and less relevant, because the longer the game goes, the less important some of that early damage becomes, especially as players start to max out. The economies get so much stronger. It's like, well, I had 25% more mining than you at 5 minutes, but now it's 8 minutes, and we both have 300% the amount of mining we had at that point in the game. So that little bit of disadvantage becomes less important. So Hyun going for this early Roach Warren, double Evo Chamber. Looks like he's gonna make maybe a couple of Roach Lair. Okay, Lair's finishing. He'll start his 1-1 and probably plus one, or Roach Speed very shortly.
This is a tricky spot to be in for Pult. He's got his Hellions out on the map. He's doing a bit of poking, but he hasn't seen the Roach Warren. He has seen the Lair, and that scan should tell him just about everything he needs to know as these queens kill the Reaper blocking the third hatchery. So Hyun starts the 1-1, as you said. The Lair's complete, so he can get up his Roach Speed as soon as he can afford it. And what I'm mostly worried about is how exactly does Pult need to respond to defend against this? Because he's moving up to three barracks, he's getting his two engineering base, and he is building Marauders out of that barracks he has back home that's already done.
Yeah, so basically just Marauder transition is going to be pretty much sufficient.
Nice block on this ramp by the Queen. Yeah. Not able to sneak those Hellions in.
Hellions, this is a very uncomfortable position for Pult right now. Besides the economic loss at the beginning, because of how far spread out the creep is, Pult does not have a good place to sit his Hellions where he's going to get really good information about what's going on. He can no longer sit his Hellions at the top of the ramp outside of Hyun's natural because there's already creep and vision up there. He can't really sit over by the third because he wants to deny that creep. And as soon as, basically, Hyun is going to get three creep spread up to that second set of ramps because it's very hard to deny creep when it's above you.
Yeah, it's a really tricky spot to be in. The 1-1 is close to completing, so is the Roach speed, but Hyun's Overseer that went through Polt's main saw that he had a factory building siege tanks, so he knows that there should be a reasonable defense against just straight Roaches. So he starts the Hydralis Den, he starts his pneumaticized Carapace, and I expect to see him just maybe go for the 2-2 timing.
Yeah, the 2-2 timing seems very likely here. If we see the... Normally, if you were going for a 1-1 all-in Roach timing, Your third would have at most 16 drones. You'd be on 3 base mineral saturated, 4 gas saturated. Hyun already going up to full 3 base saturation, and as you said, started the Hydralis Den. We'll expect to see him start +2, +2 right now. And basically, Hyun just needs to not take damage until 2-2 is finished, so about 3 minutes, he should have a full max 2-2 timing. In the meanwhile, he's going to be doing a little bit of damage here. The Overlord coming in, he may try and force a lift off and then drop some creep down.
This is a really nice way to use the Roach upgrades that he got earlier, because this isn't a committed enough force to, you would say, to engage the whole army directly. But this command center gets really low. There's the creep, as you mentioned, and he's willing to fight these units away from that siege tank because he knows there's no SCVs here to repair this burning barracks, and he wants to let this get as low as possible.
Yeah, and right now, Hyun really needs to just get out of there. He's going to end up losing basically all of these Roaches. And this should be indicative to Pult that there's a real timing coming up. This was not the timing. This was an expedition. This is to soften him up just a little bit, get a little bit of information. But that's not what he really needs to be worried about. This 2-2 with the Hydralis is what's going to be so brutal for Pult to defend here. You can see he's continuing to build siege tanks up to a second factory, and 2-2 has just started for Pult. This leaves the disparity in upgrades between the two players, means that Hyun has about a 100-second window.
Nice contaminate on that factory, and another really important part of what you just mentioned is he's moving some of those forces towards the left side, so he could try to abuse that tank count. And yep. This is still a really awkward spot. Another thing I absolutely love is whatever Pult was planning to do at the beginning of this game got thrown off so much, we never saw his classic Viking. So the Overlord spread is actually amazing for Hyun once he got Overlord speed. So anything that any counter pressure Pult could try to do, it would be immediately seen. And these SCVs are going to build depots, but these rocks are getting taken down. You said it, siege tanks are slow to reposition. Here comes the Zerg army.
Hyun coming in. You can see he's timed this build out very well. 2-2 is about to finish in about 10 seconds here. Pult has 10 seconds to make an attack on even upgrades, but it's just not going to happen. His army is way too spread out of position, did not see this army coming in through Pult's natural. Hyun forcing the battle right here. This is his moment, 2-2 against 1-1. Is Hyun going to break through? Hydralis continuing to push in, more and more siege tanks going down, and Hyun's army looks unstoppable right now.
There is very little Pult can do to stop this push. Moving the natural away, starting to head up towards the production in the main base. As you said, those 2-2 upgrades make this force so difficult to kill. And the Season 1 champion would love to take the first map in this series against a titan of Terran versus Zerg, some would say. Pult below 90 supply now. Hyun still sitting pretty at 163. GG is called. Hyun takes a 1-0 lead.
Did I tell you how much I hated Sejong?
I think your analysis, you prophesize what would happen this game. I'm impressed.
It was lucky for me. Unlucky for Pult, though.
Yeah. that's a bad spot to be in. And I think the best part about
he looks unhappy.
I would be I'm unhappy every time I see Roaches.
Just like that game started, and that was such a well thought out build from Hyun. Like very, very calculated, very smart. Using the Overlord to see the path that the Reaper took, and then allowing it to basically set up this attack by setting Pult so far behind. Hyun knew when his timing was, he knew how to maximize his advantage. Hitting, you can see Pult's 2-2, not even close to finishing, but Hyun's had just finished. So he had plenty of time to maneuver, continue to have this attack work. Easy.
And when you're trying to take fights like that, his combat shield wasn't even done, and I have to say, you know, it just, Hyun threw him off just enough that Pult wasn't really playing like Pult. He had to play to what Hyun was showing him. And I think Hyun reacted very well to that. Like I said, the The Overlords being able to see everything. He never had to pull his Overlords back. He never lost Overlords because Polt realized he needed barracks so fast. He never went up for that fast starport. Usually Polt starport is always before 10 minutes. This game, it was something like 11 minutes. He didn't even have a crazy amount of medivacs. And this is one of those things that Hyun can do to really build up momentum. And this next map, Merry-Go-Round, is also a pretty damn good map for the style that Hyun played in that first match.
Yep. And that's a... That build... Yeah, man, that was... That looked frustrating as a Terran player. It was like, how am I supposed to deal with this? Because there's really... You don't want to SCV scout as Terran. It's such a waste of time in 90% of situations. 99% of situations, the SCV scout isn't telling you anything. It's all about that Reaper getting in and doing damage. And by SCV scouting, you are decreasing your ability to transition. You've got less income. But it's like, I'm looking at this from Polt's perspective. It's like, how could he have possibly held that without SCV scouting?
Yeah, that's a really tricky spot to be in for sure. If your Reaper doesn't see those Lings, they get in. Well, I guess we, as Terrans, you know, that sets you back to the Stone Age. So we are here though, loaded in to map number 2. Our red Terran player in the top left, representing CM Storm. It is Polt. Show me what you got.
Now it's my turn.
In the top right-hand corner, Unbelievable! He was Spider-Man at I Am New York. Now he's the king. He is Hyun!
I know you liked it.
I didn't know what I signed up for.
Oh, see, he said that. QXC, you win.
Shout out to random guy in the crowd.
Yep, he said it. I don't know. Nobody said Nathanius. You win. Wait. Oh, see,
well played.
See.
Well played.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh man, if this, you better wait for game 3, man. you best bring your A game.
Ooh.
So merry-go-round.
Show match. Oh, show. He called it show match, sponsored.
All right.
Yeah, here we go.
Roaches.
Roaches?
I don't like
roaches?
Them on this map. I don't like playing versus them on this
map. No, and the biggest thing here, if we take a quick look at Polt's third in, yeah, there we go. This is a huge, wide open area. You can see there's basically no real choke points, making Roach Hydra a really strong option on this map. That 1-1 or 2-2 timing gives the Zerg player a huge range of possibilities in order to make that attack work.
Yeah, I feel like one of the other scary parts about it is it gives so much open ground if you try to attack as a Terran once the creep gets spread around there. You're playing versus some, like, even just a standard Zergling, Baneling, Mutalist style. You can hit from multiple different directions as a Zerg player, too.
Yep. And Polt opening with what we expected, just fast Reaper. And he's actually, this is interesting, he's got a fast second depot.
Yeah, doesn't want to leave himself susceptible to anything, because at least now, what we also have to look at how Hyun has taken momentum control. He forced the SCV scout out of Polt. Polt wants to know where he is, and you could say, yeah, the Reaper, whether or not it goes to his base, he'll know where Hyun is, but he also wants to make sure that if anything leaves his base early on, he can spot it. Hyun, this is a situation where you have to be feeling pretty comfortable because that command center is, without even having to do anything aggressive, it's already delayed compared to what Polt wanted to get in the last map.
Yeah, and it's a little interesting. The build that Hyun did is actually weaker on maps with more than one player or more than two player spawns, because on a three-player map, you know the Terran player is going to be SCV scouting because they have to figure out where you are. Same thing on a four-player map. And also, on a multiple-player map, gets one drone. That's nice for Polt. A little bit of a pickup helps set him ahead. But on a map like this, the reason that was so strong on Sejong was because there were two paths that the Reaper could take, and the Overlord was guaranteed to see the one that the Reaper took. On a map like Merry-Go-Round, you don't know where your opponent is, so you don't know where to put the Overlord in order to guarantee those Lings get across the map. Because if those six Lings meet the Reaper in the middle of the map, they are all dead and they are not doing any damage at all.
Yeah, I really like how Hyun's been playing the maps too. And this Overlord Scout, we'll see. Okay, three command centers. Pretty standard from Polt so far. This is about as economic as your builds really get, and these three Reapers try to do some good harass, but the way that this natural is laid out, it's not like Overgrowth where you can poke from afar and step back. The Queens will always have the high ground advantage.
Yep, so he's going to do a bit of damage here, and Polt should have a bearing on the speed timing, the fact that the speed is about to finish, and I think actually Polt, Hyun may have revealed too many Zerglings here. Hyun, oh,
overbuilding Zergling, 6 more in production. He's already got 20 lings on the map. Polt needs to do a little bit of crisis management here. If he tries to hold his natural, he may get caught completely out of position. I'm not sure how strong these 3 Reapers in a bunker will be against this many Zerglings. Zerglings going for a full surround. That one supply depot doing a little bit of work to prevent the surround from happening. SCV's repairing. Polt knows it's time to abandon. Abandon. Oh, the one link on the supply depot. All the links get into his base.
He's in the main. The SCV's forced to fight against these Zerglings. The Hellions come out with the Reapers, but he's missing a lot of mining time behind all of this. The third commander's going to finish up. Loses one Hellion. Doesn't lose any of the Reapers, but definitely a nice pickup by Hyun to slow Polt down. More Zerglings coming out. Even a drone comes to the party. I don't know if he was invited.
The drones are never invited. But fantastic. So the move that Hyun did, that what made that so effective, is as the 20 or so Lings were surrounding that bunker, he sent exactly one and sent it up on the top of the ramp and put it on hold position on top of that depot. And so while Polt was trying to micro, he's like, oh, my bunker's under attack. Let me repair it and things. And then he's like, oh, it's time to abandon. He looks at his ramp and he can't raise that depot. He's got no units there to kill that Ling, and the Ling was set there so brilliant by Hyun, so sick.
Yeah, that was a really nice catch for him. And Hyun's getting ready to follow this up with more and more aggression afterwards. These queens still holding the high ground. No third base for Hyun. At least Polt knows that. A scan wouldn't hurt him too badly as that lair is coming in with the Roach Horn. So
he's
just go right back into Roaches for a follow-up. Okay, now the Reaper gets
in. Yeah, the Reaper's going to see the lair. He's going to see 2 gases, presumably, and a third gas. The problem now is that this build actually looks more like Mutas than it looks like Roaches, because he's seen 2 gases in the natural, 2 gases in the main, lairs coming up, but meanwhile there's a Roach Horn. And Hyun's now putting down the double Evo chamber. 4 gases is, at that stage, it can feel like Mutas. The lair is a bit late for Mutas, admittedly. But Hyun did make a lot of Zerglings. And sometimes when those timings happen, you kind of lose track of the game a little bit. It's like, there's this big battle, we were microing for so long, now it's 9 minutes, but actually in a normal macro game, this would be more like 8 minutes or something. And so it's hard to be like, well, what does this lair actually mean?
Now, I like that he's been able to clean up these creep tumors. And another thing, along with what you said, is that Hyun, is from whatever the build looks like, he's got Polt once again going for something that we just really haven't seen Polt do a lot of, and that's the standard 3 rack setup. So
there's
he scans. I don't think he learns anything new from this. Maybe he was hoping to see a spire.
Yeah, so however Polt determined it, he determined it was roaches, because the factory immediately built the tech lab on. Oh, maybe he saw roaches. I don't know. That seems like a good way to determine it was roaches.
And he definitely sees roaches now.
Yeah.
And oh boy, you know what he doesn't see? There is a Nidus network on the map.
Oh, what?
Oh boy.
Interesting, Hyun. Interesting.
Hyun's going for a bit of a cheeky play.
Yeah, well,
as the EU guys would say.
And perhaps this is due to the very large main in the very large size of the main. If you look at Polt's vision right now, there's a very significant. Go ahead.
Yeah, look at this. So he's got all the SCVs at the natural. He's scared that there's an attack coming here.
Yep.
He's focusing all of his attention at defending the front against what is, you know, it's, I mean, 1-1 roaches are it's a very strong build. It's a very difficult attack to stop. But he pulls his eyes there. Now this Nidus network's done.
Here it comes. You ready for this? What Hyun's going to do is, at the same time that he builds a Nidus, maybe he's going home. Maybe Hyun is actually quite worried about the Hellions. Yep, and the Nidus goes down. Polt has no idea this is coming. The Lings trying to clean up the Hellions. The Roaches are desperately heading home. They're actually ignoring the Hellions. If Polt knew it was a Nidus, he might think that's why, but
starts
now he knows.
Second
Nidus going in, because that's what's up.
The double Nidus in Polt's main, picking off the reactor of the starport. There is a siege tank. These Roaches need to get a little bit closer to pick that off. There are still a good number of Marauders here for Polt. SCVs already coming off the line to help fight against this, but they're all dying in quick fashion. No medevacs to heal these Marines and Marauders, and Hyun stepping forward once again. Siege tank comes out. Gobble, gobble, say the Roaches, and I think Polt might be cooked for game 2.
And more Roaches streaming in here. Polt has nothing left. He's got some production, but Hyun is sitting on top of it. How can he clean up 10 more Roaches? Third Nidus goes down, because that's what Hyun is all about.
GG Hyun 2-0. The reigning champion says, I am here to stay for now. One map win away from moving on to the final four.
Hyun looks so prepared for this map. Everything, or for this match, everything is so calculated, so well thought out. Just those little differences, that one Ling on the supply depot. It's gonna give me nightmares.
That's a scary situation to be put in, especially, and you say planned out really well. That knight is played too. Polt had nothing in there, and the main base is so big, you get distracted, you're focusing on that front, because you know, Polt lost to a straight up Roach Hydra attack on the King Sejong station map. So you're like, well, yeah, I don't want to lose the front again. And then that's when you get distracted. Suddenly, two Nidus worms in your base, and you die a horrible, painful death. So yeah. Before we go on to game number three, the potential deciding map, we're going to show you guys a couple of player spots that we made on these two guys prior to their competition in the top eight. Polt has already done the damage he really wants to.
Polt has killed over 100 units in this game already.
These Widowmines are going to burrow the Banelings.
I've started to be a pro gamer since 2011. I got 5 trophies until now. I think it's pretty good numbers for me because I started it very late as a pro gamer. WCS has a lot of meaning to me. It gave me, of course it gave me 2 trophies, and also it gave me a chance to play more and more games.
Reigning WCS America Premier League Season 1 champ.
Hyun does have more of his forces here.
Great spread from Hyun.
Really well done by Hyun.
제 경력을 말하라면은 최근에 이제 시즌 1 WCS 아메리카를 우승을 했었고요. 지금도 어느 정도의 실력을 이제 발휘하고 있기 때문에 이번 시즌 2도 잘 할 수 있을 거라고 생각하고 있습니다. 이번 시즌 2에 이제 임하는 각오는 무조건 연속 두 번 우승을 해야겠다는 생각을 가지고 있고요. 충분히 그런 정도 이제 실력과 자신감을 가지고 있다고 생각을 하고 있어요.
Cool always to hear what the players have to say. I like how Hyun uses that phrasing. I'm still decent enough to play. Winning tournaments and making top 8. That's like an okay performance for Hyun.
He's decent. He's decent.
I'd say he's got some decent builds, decent roach control,
Decent macro.
At the very least, he's, it's adequate.
He's a decent player. Yeah. We'll see what sort of decency he brings into this next game on Frost.
Yeah. Polt needs to become a little bit more decent if he wants to stop these roach attacks.
Polt may be feeling slightly inadequate.
Slightly.
He may not be. Well, let's hope he brings some decency.
Yeah, at least it can maintain some decency at the end of this match, for sure. As we are loaded in, but I think we had some sort of issue. So we're gonna redo the game. So we're not in the game.
All right, just kidding.
We are just testing you all to make sure you're
paying
attention.
Everyone relax. Calm down.
All right.
Okay, you sound calm. Nobody even cares.
How do you like Frost? How do you like Frost?
Let's see. It's not my least favorite map.
Okay. I can understand that.
I actually, so the thing that I like most about Frost is that there is a second entrance into the main, which actually opens up some possibilities for Reaper Harass that don't exist on most of the current set of maps.
Yeah.
Maps like Sejong, Habitation, Overgrowth. If you control the front of your base as a Zerg player, you do not have to worry about Reapers. In Frost, if you control the front of your base as a Zerg player, you worry about Reapers jumping into your main and killing all your drones. Or scouting, whatever.
So it's, you'd say good map, 3 Reaper, something like that?
I like it for Reapers. It's because the 4 bases are so accessible and so easy for the Zerg to defend. They're all very close to each other. The mid and late game can be very difficult, especially securing a 5th base as a Terran player. The 5th base feels like it might as well be on the moon.
Yeah,
basically.
That is a good way to describe it. Frost, especially if you get cross positions, moving across the center of the map, there's almost always some creep there.
Yep.
Definitely. I'd say as a Terran, you like, I prefer if it's like horizontal spawns. Would you agree?
Horizontal or vertical, I think, are both quite good. Crosses can be very difficult just because of that really long rush distance. But in the horizontal or vertical spots, you usually have a relatively small alley in which you can push, make your attacks happen from there.
Yeah, it's one of those maps that also has a lot of those different paths you can go around for Zergling harass. I would say roach harass, but I feel like this map doesn't really ask for roaches unless you get those, I'd say, horizontal spawns.
Yeah, this is probably one of the least common maps to play roaches on. And usually with roaches, you're hitting either a 2-base or a 3-base timing. Most players aren't playing they're not playing like passive roach hydra style.
Yeah.
Because that doesn't make sense in a lot of ways. The biggest strength of the roach hydra style is maxing before your opponent, hitting timings, things like that. Whereas Mutalink Bling is a very strong passive style. And so since this map tends to favor passive style, lots of close bases to each other, long rush distances, usually that's what we see here.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. You do the first intro for this one.
In the top left-hand corner, down 2 games, one of the heroes of America, give him your support, he is Bolt!
And his opponent, up 2 games, just one map win away from moving to the Final Four for the second time in a row in WCS America, it is Rocket Young!
All right, wait. Shh. Who won? Wait. Shh. Who won? Who won? Shh. Sorry, man.
You. Okay. I got at least one there. It says I don't know. Hyun's name lends itself. I kind of cheated.
He does have a very nice name.
He has a very shoutable name.
Yes.
Like Hyun. Like, you know. It begs to be screamed.
Hyun is building.
And then the Polt cheers come from the crowd.
Polt. Polta!
This crowd's awesome. All right, so this map, I don't think either of us are surprised to see Polt opening Barracks Gas for a Reaper again.
Meanwhile, Hyun is building a spawning pool.
Not surprising either.
Hyun is building a gas geyser as well.
And Hyun may build roaches.
I don't think so, man. Not in this map.
And, so for vertical spawns, good for drops, you'd say. Yep. Does a Zerg player actually have an advantage on this compared to horizontal?
So basically the way it plays out, in the vertical spawns, usually the base you want to take is always the one closer to the center. And this is regardless of spawns, regardless of anything else. Because the base, the third base that's kind of just directly north of Hyun's natural doesn't have high ground for it to be attacked from. But that's also the base that's closest to your opponent. So normally you want to take that bottom base. Taking a fourth base for Hyun will be very awkward. He'll either have to take the one kind of far away to the east, or he has to worry about the very close rush distance in the base just above him. Meanwhile, the Reaper does get into his base, scouts the early gas, so immediately Polt knows this is like a 5:50, 6-minute speed timing. 6 Zerglings do come out. Reaper is going to do some damage. One Ling goes down right away. And a second Reaper is rallied. Polt not worrying about any possible counterattacks here. He's seen all the Lings that have come out of Hyun's base, and basically he's just waiting for the Queen to come out. As soon as the Queen comes out, the second Reaper is going to regroup, and he's going to be doing some damage. As soon as Polt recognizes that both Queens are in the natural, he has the option to try and jump into the main. Hyun has recognized that this is a potential weakness, and he's already put his 5 Zerglings at the likely jump-in spot.
Yeah, this is just smart play by Hyun, staying aware of everything that's going on, since he knows with his Overlord, it's a 3 command center build from Polt. Polt's not mixing it up too much this game. I'm wondering if, as one of the only games where Hyun, as his speed completes, he has not started any Zerglings just yet, if Polt's allowed to, is he going to go for that fast starport? I kind of miss him, the Polt Viking here. There's not been much anti-air to deal with it.
No, Polt has played a decidedly different game than expected. You can see the Reapers are falling back now. He's not even keeping a single Reaper there to gauge how many units his opponent is building. And he's actually finished his wall off at his natural. Frost, one of the smallest entrances to your natural, very easy to wall off. Probably the worst map to do a Ling run by on.
Yeah, and the thing is, though, this delays the Hellion production for Polt, too. I really feel like
Hyun has taken such good control of this series. He's dictating not only how Polt wants to open, but also just how he prepares at the start of the game. He's hurting his own aggressive capabilities just to make sure that Hyun can't damage him at the start again.
Yep, he's definitely worried about certain attacks, and you can see that is particularly evident in Polt's supply. 42 out of 73. That means he's got several supply depots that he doesn't actually need right now, and that's in order to finish that wall at the natural.
Now Roachhorn coming in still pretty early with no lair in sight. He has enough gas to start upgrades, but it's all going to go into roaches.
I'm feeling some roach bane here. I'm predicting that. Although it's only two gases, and I'm unfortunately not super familiar if there's really a roach bane timing you can do off of two gases. But no lair, no evo chambers. Both of the up banely nest totally roach bane.
Yep.
Here we go. Then it's really on Pult. He has to see this coming. It is impossible to defend this build unless you know it's coming. Hyun moving out with the roaches here, so he's going to basically. Oh no! Look at where Pult's army is. Look at where Hyun is going.
This is a really nice.
There
way
we
to
go.
Use
Roach
this
one.
Map.
Constant gas. It's hard to say whether Pult has recognized. Yeah. No, he knows.
Okay.
Look at
there's
that.
Three bunkers.
He's going up to four bunkers. Starting Marauder production immediately. He sees the Zerglings. Polt has to know at this point that this is Roach Bane. Any single Roach attack would not have this many Zerglings. Banelings start to morph. 14 Banelings are going to be done in 10 seconds.
This is a very difficult attack to stop. As you mentioned, I really like how Hyun tried to sell that third base to delay Polt's defensive preparations as much as he can.
And he's actually evacuating his natural already. Barracks are floating. Oh, they get out of the bunker just in time. A lot of banelings detonating, and it looks like the Marauders are just going to sit in the main. Hyun is taking complete control of Pult's natural, but that's okay for now. Pult on three command centers, and Pult even in workers. He has to just stabilize. Hyun is not going to let that happen. He's got two banelings, three banelings still up, six more are wharfing in. Continuing to build units. Actually, Hyun started droning, but he's got so many units. This is the last attack for Hyun. Whether or not this works, he's going into macro after it. But is this enough? Is Hyun going to go to the next round with this attack?
That siege tank did not hit the Banelings. They were able to bring that wall down. Zerglings on the right side holding those Marauders in position while the Roaches clean up the Marines. And Hyun may not kill Polt here, but he's certainly slowed him down. The one really nice thing for Polt is that he did not lose a crazy amount of SCVs. He can still move down. He can resaturate that natural.
Yep.
He's landed his third command center, and his upgrades are ahead. The tech for Hyun really delayed by the investment in this push.
Pult is definitely still in this game. He's got a huge upgrade advantage right now on almost 90 seconds of upgrade advantage, maybe a little bit more because Hyun doesn't quite have the gas to start that. But if we look at the economies of these players, Hyun is at full three base saturation right now. Lair is going to finish in just about 20 seconds, and that's going to mean a relatively quick, probably Spire. We could see him follow up with a Speed Roach, Speed Bane attack, but Hyun is getting that plus one melee, so we are not going to see Roach Hydra in this game.
Yeah, like he's going back towards the more standard, you could say, play, but he still has some Roaches on the map. He's going to try to inspire some fear in the heart of Pult, get him to keep building siege tanks, especially as on a map with as much open space as Frost, Zerglings are pretty good versus those units. And these Roaches have been really well placed to stop any potential Hellion harass. Pult, not too many opportunities for him, and even a few of these Hellions dying.
Yeah, and losing the Hellions right now, this is going to put him in a very difficult and uncomfortable position. Pult's medevacs, first two medevacs are going to be finishing shortly, but Pult has forgotten combat shields or has not had enough money for combat shields. One of the very important parts of losing control of your natural for so long is Pult's gas income is very off-balanced right now. Normally, he would have had that gas income from his natural for that whole duration. Because he lost it, all of a sudden, the armory is finishing. Pult needs 350 gas to start both of his upgrades. He's building siege tanks. He needs another 125 to start the next siege tank. And meanwhile, he needs medevacs. That's another 200 gas. Pult needs like 700 gas right now, and he's only got 300. You can see at his third, he's recognized the problem. He's building two more gas geysers. That's early. In any other game, those two gas geysers don't really make any sense. In this game, they'd not only make sense, they are completely necessary.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it could also set him off balance later.
Speed Roach, Speed Bane. And Pult knows now. He sees a large amount of roaches. He sees the Banelings. Banelings just finished Speed. Pult is wise to have continued Siege Tank production. That is literally the only way he's going to hold this attack. And he's got three Siege Tanks right now, but no bunkers. He's going to spread those Siege Tanks out a little bit. But you can see the big bulk of the Bioforce is totally out of position. This is Hyun's time. Just like Bomber pulled his SCVs, this is when Hyun is going to try and take this game. You can see a ton more Banelings morphing and getting ready for this attack.
Zorglings are going to run up, try to take the first few shots. The Roaches are moving up. There's so many, even with these Siege Tanks, blasting through. Tanks going down left and right. There's still a little high ground position, but the Overseer is here to grant some vision. Hyun says, okay, I'll take your third base instead. Moves over. These SCVs trying to run. There's nowhere to go. Third command center lifted up. Plenty of workers. Like Medivac comes over, tries rescue from Pult. Six SCVs make it out alive, but still, these Marines and Marauders taking some hits from the low ground. More Zerglings on the way for Hyun. His 2-2 is on the way. Won't be quite as behind in those upgrades, and he starts a Spire with 13 drones to saturate his fourth base.
Yep, and meanwhile, Pult has taken a huge amount of damage from that attack. Hyun did not need to go into Pult's natural because he did that attack off full three base saturation, which means just killing the SCVs at the third should be enough to give him the edge he needs. But Pult is not out at this point, only down about 10 supply. Roaches, remember, are incredibly supply inefficient, so being down just 10 supply is not such a big deal. 50 seconds until the Spire finishes, which means that Hyun's, well, he just spent a whole bunch of gas on 15 Banelings, but he's still going to be banking over 1,000 gas when that Spire finishes. I don't think Pult is ready for Mutas.
And there will be quite a few of them out of the map. This drop, though, Pult's trying to take control of that lack of anti-air, getting into that third, killing a few workers, and lifting up, only losing a single Marine in that attack. And that Spire getting closer and closer. 2-2 completing for Pult. Still just only about 15, maybe 20 seconds away for Hyun. So there's a very small window where this army is a lot stronger than it would normally be.
Yep. And, oh, Pult, pay attention here. Good. He gets a lift off. Only some small number of units die. And meanwhile, both players are about to hit 2-2. The drop. Pult is getting tempo back in this game. He has to take control of this series if he wants a chance to move on. These drops, his way of doing that, constantly making Hyun move around, distracting him, doing whatever damage he can. But Hyun's answer is going to be the Mutalis. 7 Mutalis in production. He'll be able to build 2 more. Pult now sees the fourth base.
Oh boy.
Muta comes out. The Medivac tries to speed boost away. It's got 6 health. Is it going to be unloading in time? Marines coming out, keeping the Medivac. Oh, the Medivac dies!
Banelings kill all the SCVs in this third base, just mining gas left. Overlord picked up on the right side. You said the Marines at least kind of made it, but now they're going to die. Pult's building 2 tanks at a time. He's playing Marine tank versus, I guess, just Zergling, Mutalis, Baneling. Now he hasn't really replaced many of those Roaches from the earlier phase. And Pult, he's lost a total of 37 workers this game, so this is still an awkward spot to be in. He doesn't want to move himself too open with these tanks.
This is dangerous, yeah. The Siege Tanks, they do make sense because there's still quite a number of Roaches here, and Hyun is actually going for it again. He feels the blood. He is the shark, and he knows that this is his time. He's going to move on if he can make this attack work. Pult, meanwhile, trying to defend as best he can. You can see he's spread out all of his Siege Tanks. And here we go. This is it. Can this be Hyun's time?
Roach is coming in. The Zerglings get the connections, but the Banelings, there's still a few Marines left behind this. The tanks are doing work, but all these Mutalisks still able to snipe off a few Medivacs. The Marines and Marauders hold strong for now. Hyun still with the supply lead, putting out 36 Zerglings behind this, starting additional Mutalisks, but Pult stands strong for now.
Pult holds on. His chances in WCS America are still alive.
Yeah, another couple of Banelings managed to hit that third base, it looks like. Pult's lost 45 SCVs now.
Yep.
A lot of poor SCVs have died this game, QXC. Pult steps up to that North Tower. These Zerglings, a nice pickup for him. He needs everything he can get at this point. He's still down significantly in supply.
Every little bit matters. The biggest saving, well, actually 20 Mutalis now. Hyun's Mutalis count is getting very dangerous, but Hyun's creep spread is basically non-existent, which means that one decisive fight for Pult can mean a devastating and unstoppable counterattack. Zerg always favored on creep, almost always at a disadvantage off of creep with everything else being equal. if Polt can establish a strong position outside of Hyun's base, he may be able to get the engagement he needs.
Hero Marine shutting down one of these Banelings in production. And with that bunker, a solid defense from the tank to hold on to his workers at the third base. Hyun's been doing a lot of aggression, bringing a lot of pressure. But you're right, Polt wants to posture for at least one good fight off of creep because
whoa,
it's really not
too,
that far
too
from
aggressive.
Third.
Okay, both players moving about a little bit. Hyun just trying to regain his posture. That attack didn't quite as go as well as he had hoped, but he is maxed again. He is rallying to the fight. 54 Zerglings are coming. 26 Banelings are morphing. Hyun is going to take this if he can, right here, right now.
Trying to clean up a drop in the bottom right. Oh, nice Widowmine shot on this siege tank. Banelings killing tanks. That is not quite cost effective for Hyun, but he still has a lot of Banelings left, a lot of Zerglings
moving
in. Oh, and
here we go. This could be it. This could be Hyun's chance. A decisive battle here would end the game for Polt.
Well, Polt just sitting at 120 supply. He still has a huge army supply, though. Banelings not being able to get on that high ground.
The orbital command. Is the orbital going to go down? The orbital goes down. Polt reduced to 3 bases, only 2 orbitals. Meanwhile, Hyun going up to 5 bases, and the supply disadvantage for Polt, 80 supply down.
One nice thing for Polt, he still has those fresh minerals mine on the left side, but without that orbital command, as you mentioned, you have less mules, less opportunity to gain resources, and Polt's army, every time he takes a fight, just the supply goes up more slowly, more and more slowly. The only nice thing is he's helped to trim this Mutalisk count down, but there's still over 100 lings on the map. He's making 20 more Banelings. And Hyun, his expansions are all still standing. He hasn't really taken much economic harassment this game, only losing 8 workers compared to 60 SCVs.
It looks like Hyun is remaxed sooner this time. He senses the blood. He gets a full surround up. There's no way to escape. Where are you going to go, Polt? The Mutalists are going to chase you down.
These Metafax are running for dear life. Going to try to unload on the high ground where the Zerglings have not arrived yet.
Oh, and 2 Metavacs left. One more Metavac goes down. The Mutalisk, there's just so many Mutalisks, he doesn't care at this point. You can see Hyun knows, again, it's time to die. Polt rallying outside of his base.
Polt has, he's always been known as a player that's very difficult to kill, but with less than 100 supply right now, this would truly be his greatest trick yet if he could find a way to not die after this next fight. Hyun is advancing forward. He's starting another base in the bottom right, and he doesn't have a lot of Banelings at this army. He's borrowing some Zerglings, trying to get vision. 17, 25 Banelings on the way.
Hyun's taking no chances this time.
No.
You can see his army morphing.
He's gonna have a Baneling for every single Marine, almost 2 Banelings per Marine. And if he can kill these Marines, he's got enough money. It would still be cost-effective. Mutalisk sniping off these Widowmines.
And here we go!
Hyun moving in, the Banelings behind. The Zerglings take the Widowmine shots. Polt retreating. The Zerglings holding these Marines in place. The Banelings are getting on top. The Mutalisks fighting as well. And Hyun looking for a 3-0 in this best of 5. I think he's got it, QXC.
Unbelievable. Hyun unstoppable. Here we go.
Polt into the main base. Everything, the production all gone. Hyun up 100 supply is gonna go to the final four here at WCS America Premier League.
Polt taps out and that's it. That's all she wrote.
Hyun, believable. Hyun,
unstoppable.
Hyun. A fantastic 3-0 from him saying, I will carry the non-Terran torch to the top four, and he has so far made good on that promise.
And with that defeat, the last foreigner has been knocked out of WCS America. We'll miss you, Polt. Hey guys, give a cheer for Polt.
Yeah! Really proud of the game. You guys can see our awesome crowd. Man, that's for such a good run. Definitely, with so many of his games available to be seen and studied, it certainly gave Hyun a lot of reading material going into this series to prepare for how Polt would react to certain build orders, where his Reapers would go on certain maps. And Hyun just seemed to have the perfect build for every map. It felt like Polt never had an advantage.
Yeah. Hyun knew how to take control of the game early, which allowed him to set up all his subsequent attacks. And good preparation, good reading of his opponent, Polt just never seemed to be able to get a foothold in any of those games.
Yeah, it was, you know, even from the build orders that Polt went for, you didn't really get the Polt feel as good as his control was. He managed to really do a good job of staying alive in that third game, but
yep.
Hyun just, he never, once he got control of the momentum, he never gave it up. And it's time to hear from the Season 1 champion himself on the main stage with Clutch. It's Hyun.
Thank you, gentlemen. Hyun, congratulations on making it to the semifinals. My first question, did you accurately predict every single opening that Polt had in that series?
우승현 선수 또 4강 한번 다시 올라가시게 되셨는데 축하드리고 그리고 이제 세 세트 전부 다 최성훈 선수가 시작하는 빌드를 이제 뭐로 할지 다 예측을 다 하셨었나요?
예측을 했다기보다는 그게 정석 빌드이기 때문에 사신 시작이 정석 빌드예요. 그래서 요즘에 사신 트렌드가 사신 더블 아니면 이제 배럭 더블이어서 그거에 맞춰서 연습을 했어요.
The most standard TVZ opening for the Terrans is just Reaper double. That's it. Otherwise, you have Barrack double. So I prepped for those two specifically. And Polt is known for his standard play. So it was, yeah, it just worked out.
And game number two, use the Nidus Worm. It worked. Did you smile a little bit when you knew that you could get in the back of his base with that Nidus Worm?
땅굴망이 뚫렸을 때 이제 기분 되게 좋아 보이셨는데 이제 확실하게 이제 아 통했다라는 생각이 이제 드셨는지?
땅굴 러쉬를 좀 즉흥적으로 한 건데 좀 게임 양상이 좀 독특하게 돌아와가지고 근데 이제 땅굴 바퀴가 이제 뚫리면서 이제 아니 땅굴 바퀴가 아니고 땅굴이 뚫리면서 그때 이제 게임이 끝났다고 생각을 했어요.
The game went a little bit funny and not really the way I predicted it to be. Nidus was on the spot kind of move, and when it actually worked and opened and roaches swarm out, I knew I had the game at that point.
In an interview with ESL, you said that you're going to win this for Revival. I know that it was tough to knock him out in the round of 16, so you got that in terms of inspiration, but what else has been inspiring you, and what would you like to say to your fans?
일단 16강 하시기 전에 인터뷰하셨던 16강 하고 나서 이제 했던 인터뷰 중에 이제 김동현 선수를 밟고 올라가게 돼서 정말 미안하고 그래서 꼭 김동현 선수를 위해서라도 우승을 하고 싶다라고 하셨는데 일단 한 번에 이제 한 계단 하나는 올라가셨고 이제 그 다음 이제 계속 여전히 김동현 선수를 위해서 끝까지 달리실 건지 아니면은 목표가 살짝 바뀌셨는지 그리고 마지막으로 팬들한테 한마디 해주죠.
성훈 오늘 성훈이랑 했는데 성훈이도 굉장히 친한 이제 친구여서 TSL 또 전 멤버예요. 그래서 이제 더 우승을 해야 된다는 이제 그 책임감이 더 생긴 것 같고 이제 동현이랑 성훈이까지 열심히 해서 두 번 연속 챔피언을 할 수 있도록 노력해 보겠습니다. 그리고 이제 항상 응원해 주신 이제 팬분들에게 이제 감사하고 여기 와 있는 팬들에게도 감사하고. 예.
So I first said after around the 16 was finished that I deeply felt sorry for Revival, who is a close friend that I had to eliminate him to advance. I don't know if all of you know, but Polt has also once been, we've been in the same team once, also with Revival under the Team SCV life. So I feel now even more responsible that I'm advancing through beating Revival and Polt, that I have to win this for both of them now, and I'm going to make sure I do back-to-back champion in WCS America. And to the fans out here that came to watch and all over the world watching the stream, thank you very much for your support, and I will answer to your all the cheers and your hopes.
Give it up for Hyun! Well done, congratulations. Let's throw it to Rotterdam for some more analysis.
Thank you very much, Josh, and indeed a really good series by Hyun. I think Polt played pretty good as well. It was just Hyun was doing a lot of small things right. Now, often when we do analysis, it's pretty easy to pick like one big engagement and say where it went right or wrong for the other guy. I felt throughout this series were just a lot of small moments where Hyun was doing a lot of things right and Polt just he's close but not close enough. I decided to go with the final game on Frost, and you know, we all know that Paul loves comebacks, and he's the king of comebacks, but Ion did not give him a chance to make a comeback in this game. I want to kick things off at the point where, you know, the first semi-big attack started off with Ion. He goes for the big good old Roach Bane. We see these Banes rolling in. It's a lot of Roaches, but look at how well Paul does this. Focuses Banelings, immediately hops out the Marines and the Reapers as well to the other bunker, gets so much unanswered damage out before he even starts losing units. So Polt is actually doing a pretty phenomenal job over here, also having the Marauders on the high ground doing some serious work. But still, Ion is getting the job done, and look at the production tab, immediately goes back to droning. Comebacks happen because people overcommit. Ion did not overcommit over here. He obviously made a big investment, but he did quite a bit of damage, and during all this, he made it possible for himself to still transition. Now we can just fast forward for a couple of minutes, because the exact same thing pretty much happens with the next big attack. We immediately see Ion working on his upgrades, because even though he knows I did a lot of damage now, tech-wise, I'm pretty far behind. You know, my opponent has stimmed bio, he's going to have medevac soon, and with a bunch of roaches and slow banelings, I'm not going to cut it, so I need upgrades as well. Again, pushes out as many units as he possibly can. There is a tank there, which is risky. You know, he can go for the kill, he can go all out, try to straight up win the game here, but that would be a very risky decision. He sees a tank, it's exposed, he goes for it. Once again, Polt making a lot of correct moves, you know, dropping bio units on the high ground, not trying to defend the position, that's not possible. But immediately, you know, Ion goes for the SCVs. Instead of trying to overcommit and go straight up for the kill, he goes for the guaranteed damage again, gets a bunch of SCVs, goes back, you know, behind this, fires up 2-2 upgrades, has more production, soon will go up to 4 or 5 bases as well. 13 drones as soon as he's done with this attack. And this just made it impossible for Paul to come back in this game. And I think that Ion made a lot of small calls like this, but he read the state of the game so extremely well. If he would have stayed on a certain amount of workers and just kept making units, we all know how good Paul is. Eventually, Paul's going to turn it around with his stimmed bio. But because Ion just drones up every single time at the right moment and then starts producing units again at the right moment and still transitions into, you know, either higher upgrades or getting a spire or getting an additional base, it was just not possible for Paul to crawl back into this game. I thought Ion played it beautifully. And that's pretty much all I have to say about this series. I'm surprised. Like, Ion, of course, amazing. He's our reigning champ, but it's still Paul. And I don't really expect Paul to go down 0-3 against almost anyone. Either way, it was fun. We're almost getting ready for our final series of the day, where we see the man who almost forgot what losing feels like in action. And of course, talking about Liquid Stasia, as he will go up against the unknown guy in our company, but a very fun one, Pig Baby. And that series will come up after this small commercial break.